I'm Rod Serling. You're listening to The Zero Hour. Rest your eyes. Exercise your imagination. This week, Bill S. Ballinger's sound portrait of an unlikely hero. The Heir Hunters. Starring Ken Berry. Joanne Worley. And Edgar Bergen. In Elliot Lewis's production of The Zero Hour.
Mutual Broadcasting System presents The Zero Hour. Sponsored in part by Baker State Motor Oil, State Farm Insurance, and the makers of V8 Juice.
This week, a story about the eternal optimist. Someone who always wakes up on the right side of the bed, even if the right side happens to be against a wall. It's the story of Dean Quinn, a young man born as a member of the human race, a species whose behavior patterns leave him in a state of bewilderment. It's a world perhaps gone mad that's best treated as a joke, one continuous stream of one-line gags. And the funny thing of it is, Dean Quinn gets along fine. Fine until he awakens one evening in a most peculiar waterbed and awakens to the realization that he himself has been playing straight man in a bad joke. The punchline is murder. Our story this week, The Heir Hunters, begins after this word. Picture this. A clear, star-filled, windy desert night just outside of Palm Springs. A dirt road leading off the highway, meandering through sand and sage up toward the base of the towering San Jacinto Mountains. Nestled within an oasis of tall palms, a single house. A veritable hideaway. The inside lights are on, but the house deserted. A sliding glass door is open, leading to the swimming pool. In the shadow of the diving board, the shapely body of a beautiful woman, floating face down. In the shallow end, a second body. A young man bleeding from the head and, for the moment, alive.
Oh, yeah. Where am I? What am I doing here? Ow. Must have got zapped in the head. How did a nice young fella like me get into a spot like this? I mean, my God, she's dead. And I'm supposed to be. What happened? What started it? I was in New York, okay? And I got sick with pneumonia, right? And my friendly physician said, go west to the warmth, okay? So I leave the Big Apple, and I stick out my thumb, and I head for the land of sunshine and movie stars. I arrive with a grand total of $3.68 to my name. My name, Dean Quinn. Yeah, it's all coming back. Boy, oh, think, you needed money. The superb printing company in Hollywood is a box-like brick building hiding beneath a coat of peeling pink plaster. There was a sign in the window. Bill Passer wanted. Well, I didn't know the first thing about passing bills, but I was willing to learn. I went in. It smelled exactly like a printing plant should. Ink, type cleaner, and hot metal. A fat guy was running around a small flatbed press, all hot and sweaty with ink smeared on his big horn-rimmed glasses. The press was churning out handbills printed on vivid green paper. A fat guy was looking over his Coke bottle lenses at me. Are you the boss?
Yeah. Mallop.
Mr. Mallop, my name's Dean Quinn.
Not Mallop. Mallap. Malcolm Lapp.
Oh, sorry. It's sort of hard to hear in here. You need a guy to pass out handbills?
Ever stuffed them before?
Oh, I'm an old stuffer from way back. What's the pay?
$4 a thousand. But if I find places been skipped, I don't pay.
Well, I don't blame you.
Hey, you got a bag?
Like a newspaper carrier? No.
Well, I'll rent you. Dollar deposit. Now, just step over here. Right here. Hey, see this wall map?
Yeah.
Along here. You see? This is your area.
I was really hustling. Didn't even have a place to stay, and I already had a job. It takes a gross amount of walking to stuff a lousy 1,000 handbills. I just about finished the last of my supply when I came to a dingy little bungalow court called the El Cairo. Nothing Egyptian about it. It just might have been built about the same time as the pyramids. I padded right into the courtyard, surrounded on three sides by grimy white frame bungalows. Cracked walls, brown walks, dead bushes, and a bird bath no self-respecting sparrow would use. I stuffed, crammed, and pushed a bill into every tiny mailbox on each of the little stoops. On the door of the last bungalow was a card which said, Manager. I had just left one of my green specials and started for the street when I heard her.
Wait a minute.
Well, who, me? Are you talking to me, lady?
Come here, I want to talk to you.
I just stood there for a minute with a big, stupid grin on my face, staring at this girl. And I mean a big girl. 6'1" in her stocking feet. And she was barefooted. I don't mean fat. I mean she's just big. Big all over, but in proportion. Nice features, just larger than life. And really neato kind of red hair she was wearing up, but it kept falling down. And very nice legs. Great gams. And displaying outstanding size up top. She was pretty. About my age, too, but I had the feeling she needed a man more like something off Mount Rushmore. Hello, girlo.
You can't be making much passing these things out.
Yeah, it's lowly, but honest. Better than selling violets or making charcoal.
Well, how'd you like to make a few extra dollars?
Dollars? I presume they're a form of currency unknown to me at the present time.
Got a minute? Come inside.
I walked fly-like into her parlor. The room was something straight out of a mail-order catalog, a dream of stained furniture, part wood and part plastic. I eased down on the edge of an imitation leather sofa and watched while she folded back the sleeves of her caftan.
I'm Miss Temple.
Formally, I'm Mr. Quinn.
I own El Cairo Court.
Oh, that's nice.
Well, my father left it to me when he died, nearly 3 years ago. You know, it's too much for a woman to handle alone, plumbing and patching up things, nailing stuff together, listening to the tenants complain.
You said something about me making money?
Oh, yes. Number 9 bungalow. It's been closed for 2 years, and it's filled with trash and junk. It has to be cleaned up and stuff thrown out. I don't have a rubbish disposal service.
And I don't have a car.
Could you borrow one?
I doubt it.
Well, do you have a driver's license?
From New York.
I have a car you could use. Well, of course, I couldn't pay you very much.
How much is much?
$10. Well, I know it would cost $25 to hire a man with a truck.
Look, this job, passing bills, it's still good for a few more days. If it's okay to clean out the bungalow on my own time, when I get around to it, then, well, yeah, I'll do it.
Good.
On one condition.
Well, if there's anything worth selling, you can have it. No, sell it yourself and keep the money.
It sounds good, but I'll have to stay in number 9 until I get it cleaned out. It's too far between my hotel and the printing company and here to get around. You know?
Oh, the place is an awful mess.
Well, look, if I can't stay, I couldn't take the job.
Well, all right. If you can stand it, you can stay, Mr. Quinn.
It's Dean. Now, what's your name besides Temple?
You can call me Beth.
You got yourself a deal, girl-o. I finished delivering the handbills, then made it up to Griffith Park and got my knapsack out from under the water pipe where I'd left it. Back at El Cairo Court, Bungalow 9, the heavy work began. Man, you never flashed anything like it. A solid layer of dust over everything. Old cartons, dozens of them. And stacks all the way to the ceiling of newspapers and magazines and paper bags and all kinds of junk you wouldn't believe. All of it worthless.
I brought you some fresh sheets and pillowcases.
Oh, thanks. Who was living here, a tribe of Turkoman sheep herders?
An old man, Edgar Rhine. He died.
He sure didn't take it with him. Did anyone ever go through this stuff before?
Oh, I guess so. Well, after Mr. Rhine passed away 2 years ago, some man came out from the tax assessor's office. He looked through it and then went away.
You didn't run away screaming?
I've prepared my repast for the evening. You're welcome to join me.
When I got over to her bungalow, supper was ready and waiting. The table was set for two. Meat and potatoes. My kind of repast. I could tell she was taking a shine to me. I don't want to brag, but I just have a way with women. Up close, she was better looking than I thought. About a half-size model would have been perfect.
Did you have enough to eat?
Plenty. And it was plenty good, too, girl.
It's all right to call me Beth.
Yeah, I know.
Tell me about yourself, Dean.
What's to tell?
Where are you from?
As of last week, New York. The Big Apple.
Oh, New York. Once I hoped I could go to New York, try to get a job there. I dreamed of being a showgirl. You know, one of those big ones parading around in a gorgeous costume with feathers and sequins.
Why didn't you?
I didn't have the money. Besides, I didn't have any talent. I can't sing or dance.
Well, maybe not, but you're big enough.
What?
Oh, no, I mean you've got the build for it.
You're right. That's the trouble. I'm just too damn big. Men don't like women as big as I am. Terrible thing is, I'm still a woman, but they think I'm a freak or something. Let's not talk about it.
Okay. Let's talk about old Edgar Rhine. If he's been dead for 2 years, how come you haven't cleaned out number 9 before?
Well, a couple of years before my father died, Dad needed money pretty bad, and Mr. Rhine offered to take a 5-year lease and pay the rent in advance at a 25% discount, so Dad took it. About a year after Dad, Mr. Rhine died, too. So I just locked up the place for the rest of the time.
Sounds like Mr. Rhine had a lot of money.
Not really. Oh, of course, he was a miser and saved everything. But all the county found was less than $5,000 in a bank book he had in his pocket when they took him to the hospital.
How old was he?
75, maybe. He died from a stroke.
Oh, yeah. All right. Oh, yeah, all right already. I'm up.
Oh, my back. What a mattress. No wonder, look at that lump. Oh, that'd be great if there was money in there. Oh, hey, what's this? These are bank books. Look at those beautiful decimal points. $10,000. $10,000 and another. And oh, boy, your ship has come in. I sat on the bed in that miserable little room, laughing and having a great time thumbing through my latest find. Each book was credited with a deposit of $10,000, a total of $100,000, but not in the name of Edgar Rhine.
They all had similar initials. Edward A. Rankin, Elmer B. Raymond, Elgin C. Reed, and so on. And there was only one savings book to a bank. 10 different banks. I looked inside the plastic envelope again, and I found a brittle yellow newspaper clipping. It said, Mrs. Etta Rhine Martin, 28, of 119 Turner Street, died yesterday after a long illness. She is survived by her husband, Charles K. Martin, and her daughter, Helen. Services will be held at 2 p.m. Thursday at the Willow Chapel Funeral Home. The clipping had no date and no town where it had been published. I turned it over, and on the back was the name of a store from a corner of an ad, Sabin's. Although I realized it was sort of a lousy thing to do, I decided not to tell Beth. Now, I'm as honest as the next guy, but I figured this was a special case. Besides, she'd said anything I found cleaning out the bungalow I could keep. So at least for now, I'd keep the discovery to myself.
Like some breakfast?
True words were never spoken. I'll be right in.
Coffee's ready. Help yourself to orange juice and toast.
Oh, good grits, pretty lady. You know, Beth, you look great in the morning.
Oh, Dean, you're making me blush.
Can I borrow your car today?
Aren't you going to work?
Sure, later.
Then why do you need the car?
Oh, you know, I thought maybe I'd start the day right by unloading some more of that old man's trash.
But it isn't dark. You're liable to get in trouble.
I'll be careful.
All right, take it.
Thanks. Incidentally, do you know if Edgar Rhine left a will?
I don't think so. That's what the assessor was looking for and didn't find.
Did the old boy ever have any visitors or relatives?
I can't remember anyone.
After he died, didn't anyone ever come to ask for him, make any inquiries about him?
Not that I know of. Seems to me you're asking an awful lot of questions about him.
No, I'm just wondering. Thought maybe they wanted his clothes or stuff or something.
Even so, you've been awfully interested for somebody who didn't know him.
Just to make it look good in case Beth was watching, I tossed a few bundles of magazines into the car. Old man Ryan's golden geese were tucked securely in my inside coat pocket. My heart was beating against them. Then I took off for the Superb Printing Company and my separation pay. I dumped the magazines in a big green bin out behind the brick building and went in.
Get them all delivered, kid?
You bet. Here's my bag back. I won't need it anymore.
Too tough for you, huh?
It's my feet. I wear orthopedic shoes. Can I have my money?
Here. Don't spend it all in one place.
Wait, this is only $2. Where's the rest?
Well, first I have to see if you delivered them all. Come back in a few days and pick up your check.
Oh, forget it. I won't need it anyway. I converted the $2 to gasoline and drove Beth's old crate to Universal City. Besides the film studios and the tour, Universal City features a number of other businesses housed in a couple of office buildings. The one I wanted was Clarence J. Walden and Associates. Walden was famous for digging up missing heirs. He worked on a commission basis up to 40%. I figured since this was my first time, I'd work for less. It was a large office with half a dozen desks and secretaries. Walden himself had a private office. His personal secretary, a nice gal named Nora, showed me in. Walden was a nervous, fidgety, middle-aged man. Slightly bald, and he wore glasses. There were rows of playing cards spread out on his desk. He played solitaire all through my introduction.
Red King, if I could just free this pile. What can I do for you, Mr. Quinn?
Mr. Walden, these are my credentials. Photostats, of course. I don't want you to think I'm some nut off the street.
B.A., pre-law, University of Wisconsin. Honorable Discharge, U.S. Army, Fort Dix, New Jersey.
Yes, Judge Advocate General's Corps, because of my slight legal background. I spent my hitch doing just, ordinary investigations.
Well, what's this student ID card?
Columbia University. 1 year to go in law school. I had to drop out this semester, but I'll be back next year to graduate. Now, why I'm here?
To make a claim of some kind.
Or to find an heir. I happen to know of an estate worth $100,000 in cash. No one else even knows it exists. Not even the state.
There are lots of rumors about lost estates. When we investigate, they don't pan out.
Oh, this one will. I have proof.
It's like I said, lots of rumors about estates.
Oh, this one's no rumor.
Well, it is until I see some proof.
You know, I'll need a small stipend for my services. Say, $150 a week plus expenses and, 25% of whatever you get.
Let's see, one red king.
Say, $100 a week?
$75 a week, drawing account plus expenses for 1 year against your finder's fee. Take it or leave it.
I'll take it. Smart nose, that's me. A wader inner where others more sensible would fear to tread. But not me. Not old Bean, no sir. With me, it's just one death-defying idiocy after the other. And this time, I pushed to the limit.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Heir Hunters. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour. Dean Quinn, a young man in his mid-20s, a third-year law student, charming, cheery, and suffering from chronic pneumonia. He looked for and found a silver lining in his cloudy health. He called it California and went there. He found a job passing handbills door to door at a rate of $4 per thousand. He found a girl, Beth Temple. Tall, very. Owner by inheritance of El Cairo Bungalow Court in Hollywood, and alone. Dean found a home, bungalow number 9. And he found upon waking a lump in his mattress. 10 hidden bank books belonging to Edgar Rhine, the late former tenant, and representing a lump sum of $100,000. 10 bank books, an old newspaper clipping, and an idea to find the rightful heir, and perhaps some spending money as well. Dean Quinn found a lot of things. He must have, because someone is trying to kill him for it. The Heir Hunters will continue in a moment.
If you'd fallen into the deep end, where there isn't a step to keep you from sinking, you'd be as dead as she is. But how? Walden. I remember going to see Clarence Walden. Now, why had I done that? Oh, yeah. Yeah, Edgar Rhine's bank books. I had to find the missing heir. Clarence Walden's offer of a drawing account plus expenses was one I couldn't refuse. My lightning-quick mathematical mind calculated I stood to make $10,000 if Edgar Rhine's rightful heir could be located. I showed Walden what we had to go on for openers. Yeah. What do you make of that?
Helen Martin, Saban Store, Willow Chapel Funeral Home. Any idea what year this was published or in what city?
Not yet, but I intend to find out.
Well, you did investigative work in the Army, so go ahead. I'll leave you pretty much on your own. But there are a couple of shortcuts in this business that are handy to know.
Yeah, like what?
Well, when you question anyone, forget the lost heir sort of thing. Best approach is to represent yourself from an insurance company. You got some money to pay out on a policy. Here, take these business cards.
Yeah. Clarence J. Walden and Associates, insurance representatives. Claims paid promptly.
Yeah. Well, I do have a small agency. The cards are legitimate. Where do you want to start?
Right away.
All right. Pick up your first advance on Friday.
I headed back to El Cairo without the slightest intention of cluing Beth in on anything. It was not that I'm greedy, but I figured even to just tell her might complicate matters. I'm back.
I'm in here, taking a bath. Anything new?
I found a job. Not much, but it'll do till something better comes along. You got anything to eat?
You got a new job. That's wonderful. I'll be right out.
Yeah, selling insurance. A small company.
Selling insurance? That won't pay very much, will it?
With a drawing account, I'll get along.
Are you going to keep living here?
I may have to travel a lot, so I don't want to waste money on rent. I'll finish cleaning out number 9, and you can rent it again. With old Rhyme dead, there's no reason to continue his lease.
Well, there's no reason you couldn't stay with me here. You're not going to be making all that much money, and in your spare time, well, you can help out around here.
I'll tell you what. Go ahead, rent out number 9. I'll stay with you, but I'll pay half the rent. You'll be money ahead, right?
There's coffee in the kitchen. I'll put on my caftan.
I rapped with Beth over the coffee, bringing the conversation around to Edgar Rhyme. The first time she'd ever met old Edgar was when she came down to Los Angeles for her dad's funeral. Naturally, she was more definite about her own family when I asked.
My folks were married in San Francisco and were living there when I was born. Dad wasn't a very good businessman. Finally, they just gave up. Dad moved down here and Mother stayed in San Francisco. I lived with her. Well, she worked until she died. By then, I was 18.
What was your mother's maiden name before she married your father?
Josephine. Oh, Tully. Everybody called her Josie. Why?
No reason. You got anything else to eat besides fruit?
Got a new deck here. The old one's seen better days.
Yeah. Like I was saying, it's logical to assume that Etta Rhine Martin was Edgar Rhine's daughter. Now, her daughter, Helen Martin, has got to be Rhine's granddaughter. If she's still alive, Helen's a grown woman by now. The Funeral Directors Association has no record beyond 10 years of a Willow Chapel funeral home. Our only lead left is Sabin's, the name of the store on the back of Etta's death notice. We have to locate the city it's in.
Well, I'll send out a letter to all the manufacturers' association, retailers' organizations, and credit reporting companies. Maybe pull in something on Sabin's, you know. But it'll take a while, though.
Meanwhile, I'll talk to Alvin Hyatt. He's the administrator appointed by the court for Rhine's present estate.
Keep plugging away, boy. Hard work pays off.
Any chance on calling today, Friday?
Yeah, I will tomorrow.
I may need some scratch.
2 red tens up already. Oh, this is hopeless. Let's see.
Alvin Hyatt was an attorney with offices in a bank building on Broadway, downtown Los Angeles. The tax assessor had turned over to him all of Rhine's possessions and papers to put through probate. Mr. Hyatt, my card.
Oh, how do you do, Mr. Quinn? Please be seated. After you phoned, I dug up the file on Edgar Rhine in this folder.
Oh, thanks. ME's death certificate. Cause of death, stroke. Hey, a driver's license.
Expired 1916.
Yeah, but it gives his birthday. February 17th, 1897. He wasn't married. Wasn't married.
Well, it doesn't mean he was never married. He might have been divorced or a widower.
Oh, sure, you're right. State of Washington license. Seattle address. Thank you, Mr. Hyatt.
Oh, Mr. Quinn?
Yes?
The folder?
I dropped the car off at El Cairo. Beth wasn't around, so I left the keys in her mailbox. Then I took a cab to the airport. Walden got pretty hot over the telephone when the airlines called to see if my expense account covered a flight to Seattle, but he said okay. I had copied the address off Ryan's old driver's license and had to follow it up. I took a taxi from the Seattle airport. Ryan had lived in an old 1890 vintage big brown frame house. Three stories, each needed paint badly. Yellow and purple stained glass panel in the front door. Really grotesque. A tired face, harassed, middle-aged woman opened the door and stared at me with suspicion. I knew the place was or had been a boarding house. I gave her my insurance routine and my card. She gave me her name, Myrna Coyne, and invited me in.
I don't recall any Edgar Ryan, but maybe my mother does. She's real old, but she's smart as a jaybird. Reads her Bible all day and doesn't forget much of anything, even though she's 87. My mother, Mrs. Daly. Ma likes to make up riddles about the Holy Book. Ma, you got a visitor. Wants to know, baby, you remember a boarder from 15, 20 years back?
Yes, Mrs. Daly. His name is Edgar Ryan.
There's nothing wrong with my hearing.
Oh, sorry.
Young man, who was the straightest man in the Bible?
Who was the straightest man in the Bible? Oh, you stumped me, Mrs. Daly.
Joseph, because Pharaoh made a ruler out of him.
Oh.
Genesis 41, 42, 3.
Oh, golly, that's a good one, Mrs. Daly. You're really a panic. Did you ever tell Edgar Ryan any of those?
Young man, I've talked about the good book to all our boarders.
Do you remember Edgar Ryan?
Well, I can't say as I do right off. So many boarders come and gone.
Well, he would have been in his 50s then. He moved to California.
Oh, the old sea captain. Sure he lived here.
We've got a pretty nice insurance settlement for his next of kin.
Bill, he kept pretty much to himself. But I remember one thing for sure. His name wasn't Ryan. It was Rankin. Edward A. Rankin.
So Ryan might have been a merchant marine. Big deal. That's a lot of expense money you spent to find out nothing.
Well, what I didn't find out is important. Before I left Seattle, I stopped at the library, went through the city directories.
Don't tell me. No Turner Street Martins, no Willow Chapel, no Sabins.
He wrecked. Also another stop, Maritime Union Local. Edgar Ryan didn't belong to it either.
I need this aggravation.
Here. I brought you a present.
Oh, well, where'd you get these cards? Yeah. These are dirty pictures.
Wait till you get a load of the Queen of Spades. I hitched back to El Cairo to rest up. This air hunting was tiring business. A few days later, in the morning...
Hello? Yes, he's here. Just a minute, please. It's for you. Good thing I got this long cord.
Hello?
Quinn? Walden here. We got something on those letters I sent out.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, there used to be a Sabins, a small chain of sporting goods stores in Chicago.
Chicago?
Folded sometime in the 50s.
Who is it, Dean?
I made a plane reservation for you. Can you get to the airport by noon?
Wait a minute. Beth, can you run me to the airport?
I guess so.
Oh, thanks, girl. I won't be gone long.
Quinn.
Yes, Mr. Walden. I've got a ride. What airlines?
Got a pencil and paper?
Okay, lay it on me.
Anaconda Airlines, flight number 2 to Salt Lake City.
Utah?
Yeah. I thought you were going to Chicago.
Transfer there to Thrift Skies Midwest Airlines, flight 111 to O'Hare.
When do I arrive? Next week?
Very funny. I'm trying to keep expenses down. You land in Chicago at 9:18, their time. Let me know what you find out.
I'll be sure to call collect. Goodbye, Chief. I made it to Chicago unscathed, no thanks to either airline. The only two times I unbuckled my safety belt were when we landed. I came out of it okay, but the cab driver who drove me into the city asked a lot of questions about why my nose was bleeding. I had a headache, too, but it was too cold to notice. The wind whipping off Lake Michigan reminded me how stupid I was to leave my heavy coat in California. The house at 119 Turner Street had four apartments, two up, two down. No name of Martin on the mailboxes, so I tried the first door. The little card in the door had just one word printed on it. Pazek. A big, tough, heavy-set guy somewhere in his late 60s opened the door. He hitched up his baggy trousers and gave me the evil eye. I handed him my card.
I don't want no insurance.
Oh, I'm not here to sell you any. But I'll give some money to Helen Martin if I find her.
No family named Martin live here.
Well, they did, years ago. Who owns this place?
Me. Ignace Pazek. They got pneumonia coming.
They sure do.
No trouble, no lawsuit.
Not for me, just money.
Come in. Sit down by table. Hey, Stella, two beers. How much ammonia you give Martins?
Enough. Oh, thank you.
You're welcome, Ford.
It's a very attractive girl.
Oh, Stella. She be all right. No got good sense. How you like beer?
30 above zero is hardly beer drinking weather, but it's good.
Yeah, plenty good. My brother makes it. Charlie Martin owe me plenty money. You pay me?
I can't. I'll pay Helen Martin. She can pay you.
Don't know where she live. Martin's move away.
When?
In war, Korea, 1952, 1953. You don't know where they go.
Well, that had to be after Mrs. Martin died.
Yeah.
And you don't know where they moved?
Yeah. Don't know.
Well, thanks for the brew. May I use your phone to call a cab to take me to the Drake? Mm-hmm. On the way to the hotel, I asked the cab driver if he could run me by the Willow Chapel Funeral Home. There wasn't much to it. Nothing at all, to be precise. They had gone under, so to speak, in 1955. It was pretty late that night as I sat in my hotel room with a bottle of scotch and a glass of cracked ice, trying to forget the 10 grand commission that was apparently slipping from my grasp when... Who is it?
Hi there, sport.
Stella?
Yeah, I'm colder than hell. Let me in. Here, take my coat. I didn't have a chance to get all dolled up. Grandpa would have suspected something.
Pasek? Your grandfather?
Sure. How about offering me a drink, sport?
How'd you know where to find me?
Heard you call the taxi. Thank you. I'd love a drink.
Don't stand out there in the hall. Come on in. Hey, what are you doing?
I'm lying on the bed. What does it look like?
It looks like you're lying on the bed. Why did you come here, anyway?
Pour me one.
How old are you, Stella?
Old enough.
What do I owe this visit? My personal charm, or what? Here. Here's your drink.
You sure took long enough. Maybe I like you, sport. Also, maybe we can help each other.
That's two maybes.
Today, Grandpa didn't tell you all he knew about Charlie.
Well, what do you mean?
Now, you're going back to Hollywood, right? You take me with you.
Boy, oh, you didn't hear that. Stella, let me put it to you this way. You're an attractive girl, but you don't stand a chance out there.
I don't want to be a movie star. I'll find a job, anything, just so I can get out of here, away from Grandpa. All I want is money for a bus ticket, and I'll tell you what you want to know.
Well, fair is fair.
And you let me stay here till I go.
That's not fair.
Okay. Try to find out for yourself about Anna Martin and Charlie and Helen Martin. Where's my coat?
No, wait a minute. Look, I can't let you stay. If your grandpa and your father find you here, they'll tear me apart. I'm very breakable.
I asked for my coat.
Oh, look, Stella. In California, you're going to be on your own. I'll get you there, but that's all.
A real gentleman doesn't keep a lady waiting for her coat.
All right, all right. All right, you can stay here till bus time in the morning. Now, about your grandpa and what he didn't say about Charlie Martin.
You understand, my grandpa didn't tell me this. But when my mama was alive, sometimes I'd hear her talking with my old man about Charlie Martin.
Yeah, go ahead.
When Grandpa Pasek was young, he was always chasing women. He liked pretty girls even after he was married. In those days, he had a good job on the railroad. So did Charlie Martin. The two of them were very, very good friends, so Grandpa rented Charlie and his wife an apartment upstairs. Charlie was younger and even bigger than Grandpa, and...
And Mrs. Martin was very pretty, and Ignace, the old lech, had his eye on her. Yeah, I get the picture.
Well, maybe Etta was a good woman and didn't give in. Maybe not. Who knows?
Yeah, keep going.
Well, the Martins had a baby, a little girl they called Helen. Then Mrs. Martin got sick and died. Everybody was quite surprised because she was such a young woman. There was a big funeral at the...
At the Willow Chapel Funeral Home.
Are you going to keep on interrupting, or can I go on?
I'm sorry.
All right, so Charlie Martin came back to the apartment after the funeral and went out in the garage and beat the hell out of Grandpa. Nearly killed him. Remember that big scar?
I remember.
How about a refill?
Finish first.
So Grandpa had to go to the hospital. When he got out, he came looking for Charlie. He wanted to get even, have him arrested, sue him or something. But he couldn't find him. Charlie was gone.
Where did he go?
Joined the army.
Where's Charlie Martin now?
Still in Korea, but he ain't coming back.
Why not?
Charlie Martin is dead.
You are listening to Mutual's presentation of The Zero Hour.
Tomorrow at this time, rest your eyes and listen here to this week's continuing study in suspense, The Air Hunters. I'm Rod Serling, and this is The Zero Hour.
Today's episode brought to you in part by Wrigley Gum Cold Power and Chevrolet. This is The Zero Hour on Mutual Radio.
You have been listening to The Zero Hour, a presentation of the Mutual Broadcasting System in association with Hollywood Radio Theater. Heard every weekday at this time. Rod Serling is your host. Zero Hour is produced and directed by Elliot Lewis. The Hollywood Radio Theater theme was played by Ferranti and Teicher and is now available on United Artists Records and Tapes. Hugh Douglas speaking. Tune in tomorrow and once again...
Rest your eyes and listen here.
...to The Zero Hour.
This is the Mutual Radio Network.